flu test has a swab test. The strep throat test has a swab test. Now that one goes down your throat.
Those are solutions.
Right, that goes down your throat. So that one is really even more uncomfortable.
Not for Miss Monroe.
Man, you took the words out of my mouth.
You took the words out of my mouth. Y'all never gonna let that go.
Episode one.
Not for Miss Monroe.
She taught us about
the throat.
She
gotta relax her throat.
No.
Oh my God. Anyways.
Welcome to the TMF podcast, where we have too many feelings. I'm your host, T Staples, and I'm joined by
Miss Monroe today, bringing you very political vibes.
Oh, really? And who else we got on the mic?
We got you. You already know what it is. It's your main man, Freddie B. We here, and I'm going to do what I do. You already know what it is.
And for all you listeners out there who don't know it, we have been doing this podcast in the midst of a pandemic. So let me be the first to tell you that we're bringing you all these feelings from the comfort of our homes. And guess what? We got Freddie B back, y'all. He's not in the islands no more. Freddie B, where you at?
He didn't get swept away.
He didn't get swept away. He got it. You made it out of Delta, I heard.
Man, yes. I made it out of Mexico on my essay. Shout out to y'all. But I'm back in Manhattan, back stateside. So we here.
And Miss Morrow, where you at today?
In the A, baby.
That's what's up. And you know, it's your boy T Staples coming out of Brooklyn. So look, if you like what you hear on this show, check out our handles. They're in the descriptions below. We'd love to hear your feedback on how you feel. And today, we're going to open up and give you some stories of our experiences dealing with COVID-19 during this 2020 pandemic. And later, we'll have a special guest to ground some of our feelings on COVID-19. But first, it's a segment I like to call The Internet Never Lost.
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah. But actually, today's clip does not come from the internet. It comes from some of our local news stations because our commander in thief or chief, because some say he stole the White House, but commander in chief that just caught the COVID. Now, I call it the COVID colloquially. You know, he caught COVID-19. And we're going to, like I said, we have an expert on. We'll let her explain more about what it really is. But, you know, he caught the COVID. And here are some clips from our good media people out there. Check this out.
At least 27 people connected to the administration or campaign have tested positive. At least two of them, the president and first lady, gathering to honor family of fallen military members last Sunday, an event President Trump seemed to blame in part for his infection.
I met with Gulfstar families. I didn't want to cancel that. I can't back up, Maria, and say, give me room. I want room. Give me 12 feet. Stay 12 feet away when you talk. They come within an inch of my face sometimes. They want to hug me and they want to kiss me. And they do. And frankly, I'm not telling them to back up.
You need to tell them to back up. First of all, I ain't never known nobody want to hug and kiss him. But I guess there are some people who want to hug and kiss him. But from his favorite, you know, pastime, Fox and Friends, on the Tuck Carlson show, we had this other little thing.
Well, to learn more about the process of the president's recovery, our own Dr. Mark Siegel spoke to Donald Trump today.
How are you feeling now?
I feel really good. I feel very strong. I know a lot of people that have had the COVID or the China virus, as I call it, because it came from China. But
what were the two most prominent symptoms that you had?
I think didn't feel really strong. I didn't have a problem with breathing, which a lot of people seem to have. I had none of that, but I didn't feel very strong. I didn't feel very vital. I didn't feel like the president of the U.S. should feel. I just think that it was just you were tired. You were, you know, it was just getting to you from the standpoint you didn't have that same energy level. And, you know, my life is based a little bit on energy and you didn't have it. I got lucky, I think, with a certain medicine. You would have sort of a sore throat. Just to add to what we were saying, but I felt really very, very good after taking this for a period of time. It's a transfusion, not a shot. And, you know, I'd like to send it to everybody. In fact, I've said I'm going to send it to everybody that's got the problem, and we're going to send it free of charge, including seniors, of course, but we're going to send it to everybody.
Wow. Wow. So, look, thank you, Nightly News with Lester Holt's Haley Jackson and Tuck Carlson's Mark Siegel for those fantastic little pieces of firsthand account from Donald Trump himself, or should I say more formally, President Donald Trump. This has been yours truly, T. Staples, in this week's edition of The Internet Never Lost. Never lost. Catch you next time. Freddie B, Miss Monroe, what y'all think about that segment, Internet Never Lost? Like, he don't know if he was sick. He don't know how he feel. I feel good. I feel bad.
I'm confused about that last statement he made. Did he say he was going to send the medication for free to everybody?
Oh, yeah, he said that. That's his actual words. That's why I want to play those clips. You know, because, you know, a lot of times the internet, they twist everything. I say, no, I'm going to play what he actually said.
In Medicare for all.
Right. Oh, I see. I see where you're going. Right. I thought Bernie Sanders said that.
Right. I'm like, I thought your party was completely against that, but you're talking about sending medication to free for right. all people.
Right.
You're interesting. So you are on board.
All right. Oh. So it's not just the Democratic Party.
You know, Trump. He says non-quantifiable stuff. He says, you know, we're doing great work. Everybody loves it. You know, even some of the Democrats, even some of the Republicans, they love what I'm doing. I'm doing a great job. Everybody's happy there. He just says these things and it's like, it's not right. It's not wrong. It's like, because it's not quantifiable. It's like, you know, a lot of people. What is a lot?
I feel bad. I feel good. Like, I feel, well, my nose hurts. My nose was hurting, but I feel good. I feel great. I was tired of not how a president should feel, but I'm feeling great.
And then he also talks like he was talking about himself like a superhero. I don't feel like how a president should feel. You know, my vitality was a little low. Your vitality. You sound like you a man in a video game.
Fred, don't clean it up for him. His vitals. That's his vitality. I'm like, them are two different things, sir.
Right. Man, this has been crazy. Okay, so look, let's do it like this. Let's get right into it, y'all. I'm going to get both of y'all to tell me a little something about your experience with this pandemic world. But let's specifically talk about, you know, in relation to COVID-19. Miss Monroe, I know you were not a frontline worker, but you was in the medical field. You know,
yeah, I was a frontline worker. I was a patient care tech, which is like nothing. Like basically a nursing assistant. I worked in the clinics.
So you can get along with, I guess, real well during the day. You can get along with her real well. Okay. But tell us.
Yeah. So my experience with it was, it was kind of weird at first until I had a nurse practitioner who had, I guess she kind of minored in epidemiology. I think she took more classes in epidemiology than she was required to. And epidemiology is basically the study of, and don't quote me on this. I know I'm not going to say
You said that
exactly
word three
right.
times, by the way. I don't think I can get that word right once. I've been messing folks up. We was naming folks earlier. Epidemiology. Let me get the epidemiology from them.
I used to be friends with somebody who studied that, so I had to learn how to say it correctly. The study of how viruses and diseases spread. Mm-hmm. And how they affect communities, I believe.
Okay.
So she has studied it more.
Non-scientific answer, that is. Non-scientific. I'm going to try to delineate that.
Okay. Well, yeah, so right. I just looked it up. It's the branch of medicine which deals with the incidence, distribution, and possible control of diseases and other factors relating to health.
Scientific answer.
Right. But in talking to her about it a little bit more, she kind of gave me, I guess, a more realistic view of like the effects it was going to have on us and how long it was going to last. Like, because by the time I had worked under that nurse practitioner, I think it was like April or May. And so when everybody else was kind of thinking in their minds that, oh, okay, by August we'll be fine, everything will be good, you know, everything will be closer to normal, she was like, no. And I was hoping that it would be, because I know what our flu seasons are like. Like, after 2017 of being at the clinic, I really thought about quitting. Because, like, I would get PTSD every flu season.
But breaking news, though. Did you not, in fact, quit due to issues around the virus?
I did that because of the company I worked for. Because profit was more important to them.
Okay, breaking news.
They were trying to make us see patients. So this is the thing I used to argue with patients about all the time. If you have a virus, there's really not much you can do to treat a virus. So when people come to us and they get, you know, runny nose or, you know, things like that are symptoms of a virus, they usually like make you wait it out to make sure that it's not, because there's no point in giving you this medication. It's not going to do anything. We had a drive through. The company had like made a deal with, a lot of companies did. They made deals
so
with the state.
Y'all niggas had cars pulling up taking tests. Let me get that test and a large fry.
I opted out of working the drive through because I didn't know if it was going to be safe or not. And I'm around a family member quite often who's immunocompromised. Mm. So, the contract was only supposed to last a certain amount of months. And as it was coming close to an end, they were trying to figure out how they were going to have us still see COVID patients. And I have failed my fit test for my mask. And so what they do is they make you make sure that basically the seal is good on your mask. They were like, oh, okay, cool. Well, we're going to start seeing people in the clinic. And I was like, okay, but we're not prepared for that. Like, I can't, you know what I'm saying, see these people safely.
Oh, wow. Freddie B, talk to me, man. You've been traveling all around during the COVID, man. Freddie B has not been social distancing, y'all. But he say he has. But in my opinion, Freddie B, you selfish, man. I think, you know, I guess when they come on, I'm going to tell on you. I'm going to tell on you to her. So I'm just going to let you go ahead and tell us about your experiences with not doing right, traveling all over the world. Worldwide Fred. That's what they're going to start calling you. Watch. You know what I'm saying? Have you experienced any backlash from like people like, oh, he getting on the plane, or like people in your life outside of us, you know, just people who have had any concern for you? Because I know you've been everywhere this year, you know, but you almost out of getting a pandemic out here. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, I'm pretty sure, because they have this thing called travel shaming. So that's became a thing. I mean, well, you, right. It's like they got fat shaming, travel shaming. They got some of every type of shaming. But the travel shaming deal is like, yeah, if you traveling, people like, oh, wow, you should sit down, stay home, and don't do this, this, that, and the third, and just, you know, stay in the house. Mm-hmm. I'm sure people probably have. I haven't really posted like, oh, I'm here like that. So there's that, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. I am aware of it. But I live by myself, so I'm not taking care of anybody. I don't have to worry about that. And then as far as traveling, I mean, because actually my mother and my brothers, they got that old COVID back in like March or April, I think.
So your mom and your brother got the old COVID, because you were still new back then. You got the old COVID? So that's what's up, man. That's what's up. That's, yeah, I say how you think about the COVID. It's the old COVID.
Right. They got that old COVID on them.
And how did they do?
From what they told me, my brothers, you know, they bounced right back like cook crack. And my mom.
Dog. What the hell?
You bounced back like cook crack. Oh, quotes of the day.
But my mom, she, you know, she's older. She's 60. Mm-hmm. And so she got it. And she was saying she lost her smell and her taste for like a week. Like she got sick, like she had like a cold. And then mm-hmm. then she mm-hmm. lost that the second week. And then she said it took about, in all, it took about 2.5-3 weeks before she started feeling better. For a point, she was like, oh, I think I might want to go to the hospital. But then she just, it was just the fact of it's COVID is new. I think that's the, and that leads me to my whole point. It's actually not as crazy as the media is putting it. It's just that it's new. You look at it like, oh no, COVID is actually weaker than the flu. It actually ain't even, you're right, it's not the flu. It's actually weaker than the flu. Because if you go back and look at when influenza first came out, it first dropped on the streets, like influenza was knocking mugs off. I think like worldwide, like,
is influenza mixtape? Like, what you talking right. about?
Yeah, man.
When it first dropped, like when it came out, like, dude, people was dying when it first dropped. Right. I'm telling you, saying that record was hot.
Like, right. So what I'm saying, influenza went platinum. Is what I'm saying. Influenza went platinum. I think went almost double platinum worldwide.
And let me just be clear to all our audience. We are not scientists, okay? But I'll give you some scientific data that
we
just pulled from
common sense.
This is us talking common sense, but I'm gonna give you some scientific data I just pulled from the CDC as of 12:20 PM, October 10th. It's 7.6 million cases in the US. So the actual number is 7,641,502, if you want to know the actual number. And total deaths is 213,000 total deaths in the USA. So there you go. There's 7.6 million cases, 213,000. So we're talking about 1% in cases, 0.01% in deaths, right? Because we got about 300 million people total in the U.S. But that's interesting, Freddie B. So you're really taking the standpoint of it being new is what caused a pandemonium. You weren't subscribing to the same level of care that other people were taking with it, is what I'm kind of getting.
I mean, like, the thing is, I have a media degree, and I understand how the media works as well. You know, it's about clicks. It's about, like, now it's about clicks. Back in the old days before internet, it was about views. So it's about getting people to click on your stuff, and you get people to click by being salacious.
Yeah. I can feel you. I see where you're going with this. And I see you got a lot of emotionals, and you got a lot of feelings about this. You got too many feelings about this, man.
Because I'm tired of it. I promise I'm tired of it. I want to go back to the club. I want to host some events. All these concerts, I don't love all this money, I don't love. I'm tired of it.
I see. Listen.
If you want to stay in the house, stay in the house.
Listen.
If you want to go out, go out.
So I'm going to stay in the house side because, so, you know.
Same here.
So what happened was.
Stay y'all ass in the house. Don't leave out there.
Well, I had a different experience with it. You know, with every nurse and doctor in the family had everybody on like, okay, do this. And with me, I'm like, listen, I can't afford to be out here. I just had surgery last year. I had back surgery last year. I can't afford to be out here catching no stuff that I can't knock off. I can't get rid of. I'm going to stay my behind in this house. The gig, the job let me work from home. So I decided I'm going to follow all of the guidelines that are being issued by the government and by the authorities in my local municipality, which is, you know, Harlem. So, and also because of my friend network, you know, I would have friends and I see them posting, one of which we're going to have on in just a few minutes here, that they would just post these different tricks and tips, you know, best practices. And so I was like, well, let me follow that. And let me just tell you guys, I don't know if you guys have had your COVID-19 test, or Freddie B, have you had one?
So, man, I went to the little clinic and it was like, oh, you got to come back next week.
You, I think you really need to take one. Just so you should take one and you should get the little blood. So I went to the clinic. I got they did the blood test, which tests you for, I think, antibodies. And then they did the swab test. And the first time I did the swab test twice. So the blood test came back negative like in 2 days. Swab test came back, I think the word is inconclusive, basically saying that they could not accurately measured. So then what they did is they went back, they had me come back in, take another swab test, and then this time they touched my brain, and like, I don't know why, I was like, you in my brain, man. I'm like, what are you doing way up here?
I know that hurt.
Yeah, I'm definitely gonna ask why it was all up in there. I was like, oh my god, like, Jesus, I can't even think no more.
No, they put a chip in your head, man. You got the mark of the beast.
That's what I think. I was like, she put a chip in there. Oh, what is she doing? Oh my god. She said, I'm so sorry. Right, she was here, very nice nurse, very, very nice. I don't know if she was a nurse or a doctor, but very nice lady. But she went back there. She was scraping something. I think I lost
some memory.
That's
how the devil do. That's how the devil do. He be nice.
I can't say the word. But the epidemiologist, I think she scraped brain matter out. I said, you scraped my whole vocabulary.
No, I'm not allowing this on the show. We are not.
That's how the devil do. The devil, he a lie. You know, he be nice. No. He just slide. He slipped a little dress like light wind. And then he slide right in.
No.
I was like, oh my god. So when she came out, they did that test, and it was, you know, a few I forget, it was like 3 or 4 days later, and it came back negative. So I, you know, as far as of that moment, because this is what they also tell you when you go, is that, well, this is just for right now. You may have to take another test, you know, and it may be different. And because of that moment, you know, I was COVID free. So I was like, yeah, I'm COVID free. And telling people my test, I'm like, I got COVID free. COVID free. I'm doing dance, COVID-19 free dance and everything. And wow. But yeah, it was not the most pleasant experience, I will tell you. But at the same time, it's one of those things that I did, being responsible. Because the reason why I took the test is because I had just traveled for a wedding. And at the wedding, it broke out some kind of way. Luckily, I just didn't get hit. So I got lucky.
When you say it broke out, COVID broke out, or the Funky Chicken, Cupid Shuffle broke out?
Well, all that broke out. You know, Funky Chicken, but the Cupid Shuffle definitely broke out.
Right.
But actually, the COVID it came back to some of the people that in the wedding party. Actually,
oh, that old Rona came to the wedding. God damn.
Came to the wedding to celebrate.
Crashed the wedding.
And was so I was being responsible because, you know, I had my mask on. I did that. And then I did social distancing as much as I could. Of course, I was there working, so I was trying to help out. And then also, I had to travel the next day to my brother's first baby shower. So if I would have had it and then passed it to the his girl who got the baby, I would have felt real like some shit. So I said, let me go ahead. I know I heard it broke out. I just got off the plane. They doing contact tracing in New York. I don't know if they did this for you, Fred, when you get off the plane, but they make you fill all these papers out and all this stuff. You come from a hotspot.
No, they haven't. I done flown back to New York, I think, like 3 times. And everybody say they do that. See, they have not done that to me,
would,
not one
they
time.
They will let you come through, but they ain't let me come through. They made me fill all this information and all this, but I went and got my COVID test. And what I did was, you know, again, having people in the medical field, they told me, well, wait 3 or 4 days. So let it, like, if it mm-hmm. is in you, stay right. Home, quarantine, but wait a few days, then go get the test. So we did, and then came back negative. So I'm happy, and I've been feeling good. I haven't had any symptoms or anything, but, you know, we also got the negative test back. So
Miss Monroe just been staying in the house because she don't like people. It ain't got nothing to do with that old Rona. She's like, you know, it's people.
I mean, that is partly it. I don't like people, but I do miss being out. I do.
Yeah, we all miss it. What? I expect you to say that, honestly. I thought you were going to say something else.
Miss Monroe, who you miss?
I didn't say that nobody specifically. I mean, I do miss my some of my family. Right. I haven't been able to see.
Okay, right. She's trying to play this hard. Ain't nobody specifically.
Hold on. I know you miss somebody. Bring men into it. And I'm like, I wasn't talking about
that. No, I know. That's what you assume. See, when you assume what happens,
you
assume
I don't like being out. So we even.
No, I didn't assume that. You solidified. I said it. You said you right, but I'm starting to miss people. That's exactly what you said.
Well, listen, we're going to take this opportunity right here to bring in somebody I love and cherish, my good friend of many years, a sister from another mister. Is that what they say? A sister from brother from another mother, sister from another mister?
That's what the girls say. Yeah.
That's what girls say. Okay, cool. Boom. I just make sure I got that right. All right. Hey, listen, we got Miss Jihan El Shabazz, Director of Rehabilitation and Occupational Therapy. You on the line, Jihan?
I'm here.
Y'all, this is my girl right here. Let me tell you right now, she's been posting and letting us know what to do about this Rona, as they say, the COVID-19. So, okay, you've been listening to us talk. We gave our feelings on, you know, Miss Monroe talked about working, you know, on the front lines. I know you can kind of relate with that. And Freddie B just, I don't know. I told him, I'm telling him, like, I don't know what he doing. He out here. Mm-hmm. This man, I've been everywhere.
Being around the world,
being and a super spreader.
Exactly. And then me, I've been like trying to abide by the guidelines and do everything. So based on your firsthand experience, Jihan, what would you say? What should we do? Should we be abiding by these guidelines? Should we just be kind of loosening up? I mean, where are we right now?
Well, it's in my opinion, I think that we should still be abiding by the guidelines. You have to also remember that we now have the age of where people are anti-vaccination.
Right. They're not going to take the flu and all that.
Well, not even that. You have people who don't want to vaccinate their children. And so you have.
Oh, right. So they haven't had a vaccine.
Right. So now you have, there are some people out that have not been vaccinated against anything at all. And so they count on what's called herd immunity, as you've heard in the news. And they talk about, well, that's what we want to achieve. That's the goal. Is to where we can come together in large numbers or clusters, and our immune system on its own naturally can fight off whatever disease, fight off this, fight off that. You're a kid, you get shots, you get your booster shots, so you get a polio vaccine, you get the MMR. Some people do tetanus, meningitis. But once you get about...
Give me everything.
Yeah, once you get about maybe like one round or two of the MMR vaccine, your body becomes immune. For me, I can say I had a severe egg allergy when I was a child. And so a lot of vaccinations contain eggs. Flu vaccination does. The MMR shot does.
Is there like a base or something?
Yeah, it's like the base. So what they do is when they create vaccinations, the way that they store them or harvest them, they do it in egg embryos. So if you have an allergy to eggs, then getting certain vaccinations can cause you to have a reaction, like the yellow fever vaccination, like I said, the flu shot. And so people are counting on it. Politicians are invested in pharmaceutical companies. So right now they're kind of doing whatever they can to try to figure out, how can we develop this vaccination and how can we do it quickly? You know, because that's also another factor, is they want to do it as soon as possible. You know, because you had 7.6 million cases. You've got all these people that have died. So how can we get this vaccine out now? Mm-hmm. How can we do it quickly? You know, so that way we can make this go away. Right now, that's pretty much the government's main agenda.
And Jihan, I wanted to jump in real quick and ask you, too, as far as the vaccine. How do you feel about, because I know some other medical professionals I've talked to about this, don't even plan on taking it because there won't be any long-term studies of the effects of the vaccine with them trying to produce it so quickly.
Right.
So how do you feel about that?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I'm not taking a vaccine that is pretty much just coming off the shelf. You know, I look for evidence-based practice.
Mm-hmm.
Even as right. a therapist, all the interventions and the things we do, and you know this, everything we do has to have a science or evidence behind it. Not to say that I mm-hmm. may never take one, but I just won't be one of the first ones lining up.
I agree right. with you.
Right. I mean, because I don't even want the first cell phone off the lot.
No.
Let alone a vaccine.
No.
Like,
not
I'm good.
All. I mean, right.
Take my chances.
It goes to anything. It's just like you remember when one of those cell phones, the Galaxy or something, was blowing up. You know, this. You got this hot new phone coming off the shelf, and now you can't take it on the airplane because it could blow up inside the plane.
It's
so
the
it's
bomb.
Like, no, I'm good. Right. But there are gonna be some people.
Oh, wait. Yeah. Side note, did y'all ever see that video of the girl that took the flu vaccine, but she couldn't walk forward
yes.
correctly? She could only walk
yeah.
backwards?
Yeah. You have,
mess my walk up.
Yeah, hell you no. have a lot of side effects. I mean, even with the flu shot, you have a side effect called Guillain-Barré syndrome, which basically is paralysis. Mm. For some people,
oh,
and
wow.
you don't know if that's the side effect you will, you know, experience.
Right.
So we doing a lottery with side effects.
Exactly. I mean, it's just like I said, if you pay really close attention when you hear commercials about drugs, they say, don't take this drug if you're allergic to it. Well, how do I know mm-hmm. I'm allergic to it? Unless I take it.
Right, right.
You know, right. and there are certain...
And you get the side effects and find right. out later on, right?
And then there are certain clauses... And any time when you take a medication, and drug companies protect themselves from litigation, you know, they always mm-hmm. have something in place to say, well, you knew what the risk was. Your doctor informed you. So if your leg falls off, don't come looking for me, you know.
Wow.
Right. But I do want to say, because I don't want to discourage people from getting vaccines.
No, of course. I mean,
typically they will. I know where I work that we would have a sheet in a form. That's why we make you fill that out to
exactly.
say, hey, you're acknowledging that you haven't taken another vaccine in the mm-hmm. last 28 days, that you've never had this reaction. Have you had this vaccine before?
Exactly.
You are something similar. You know, we try to check all that stuff first. I don't want to discourage people.
No. Bump all that, Miss Monroe.
Right,
bump
people,
all that. I don't want my leg to fall off. Bump all that. I don't care what you're signing.
You definitely want people to take the measures that they need to. I mean, a lot of vaccinations now have a lot of science behind them. So I'm not an anti-vaxxer. I'm not going to take the new one flying off the shelf.
Right. And have you had to, so going to work, have you dealt with a lot of patients that have COVID?
Oh, yeah.
I'm assuming you probably had to give tests and all kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah. I've had a lot of patients who've had COVID. I've actually had coworkers who have died. From complications of COVID. I've seen mm-hmm. probably about 30 or 40 residents at a nursing home die from complications of COVID. So I've seen it firsthand. And being in my position, and it's kind of what Ms. Monroe said, to mm-hmm. where they expect business as usual to continue. You know, they feel like this is your
right.
job. We're going to give you X, Y, and Z to protect you. And we expect you to show up and we expect you to work. And if you don't want to do mm-hmm. that, then there's the door. You know, they're not
wow.
really giving you much of a choice. I've had a lot of coworkers who have quit.
And do they make you take a lot of tests and things?
Oh, yeah.
They,
I've had 11
I'm assuming
COVID
y'all
tests.
Probably got the rapid test.
Yeah.
You had 11?
Well, no, I've had...
Jeez. Did you have the one that touched your brain like
yes.
I was talking about?
Because the thing...
Oh, my God.
I've had 11 COVID tests. My job, it's a requirement to get tested. If you don't get tested, you can't work. It's pretty much it's an all or nothing kind of a deal.
Mm-hmm.
Rapid tests, believe it or not, and that's the other thing that they don't tell you, they're not as reliable as the nasal, the PCR test. So
I'm assuming mm-hmm. the PCR sound more like it touch your brain.
Yes. PCR is
the
nasal
way up in there.
The nasal okay. swab that goes up your nose.
And what are they getting? I mean, what are they when they go so deep in there? Because this is what I couldn't understand. Like, why she had to go until she took my memory? Like, what is she trying to pull out of there?
Well, you don't have to go that far.
This nigga thoughts, his dreams, his aspirations.
Yeah, you don't have to go that far. That's a bit ridiculous. But what they're trying to do is they're trying to go into the mucous membrane and they're trying to scrape cells and get the cells onto the swab. And then the swab has a solution, which is what you put into the tube, and then it goes out to your lab, you know, and they and
I'm
they
glad
do
you
that.
Said that.
Yeah.
Because I did see them. I saw some stuff in the tube, and I was like, I think that tube contaminated. But I didn't want to say nothing because it ain't my career. Yeah. I don't know. But I was looking at it. I was like,
And there are other swab tests, like the flu test has a swab test. The strep throat test has a swab test. Now, that one goes down your throat.
We all dip those in solutions.
Right. That goes down your throat. So that one is really even more uncomfortable.
Well, not for Miss Monroe.
Man, you took the words out of my mouth. I was
God. You took the words out of my mouth. I'm never going to let that go.
Episode one.
Not for Miss Monroe.
She taught us about
the
throat.
She trying to relax her throat.
No.
Oh, my God. Anyways, so I have a question for Jihan for long-term effects of COVID, because as Freddie, we mentioned earlier, I think a lot of people are getting relaxed because the death number, the death toll is kind of going down. But I think what's not being talked about is, one, the long-term effects of people who have COVID, who have survived, but they're experiencing complications later. And two, how flu and flu season, strep and RSV are going to affect those numbers again, you know, as we're entering the flu season.
Right. Yeah. What they're expecting and kind of what we're preparing for is for cases to go back up. Which is why you have such a big push for you to get your flu vaccine this year, is because they're expecting for cases to rise. The long-term effects that I have seen have pretty much been like, we've had a patient that has had, and actually I can only say one, but we've had one that's experienced like cardiac issues. So pretty much what the virus did when they got it is that it infiltrated their heart muscle. And so they experienced things like cardiomyopathy, which means that the muscles in the heart are not as strong as they were before.
Oh, wow.
Some people
COVID can damage your heart?
It can. Wow. It can cause long-term respiratory effects. So people who were not oxygen dependent now can be. Now, all of these side effects are pretty rare, which is a good thing. I can tell you also, I have had COVID. So, yeah, I had COVID-19 back in August. So let me
before you go into your story about it, because we did have the Internet Never Lost clip with Donald Trump. And did you do you think that you got the best of care when you had, like, did you, because you're in that field, you knew what to do, like what medicines to take?
So what I did is I called the emergency room just to kind of get a gauge on if they are, you know, what is the recommendation. Pretty much all they do, and what your job also would do, is they just tell you to stay home. If you are asymptomatic, you stay home for 10 days. And the crazy part is that the CDC does not require you to be retested to go to work if you're asymptomatic. If you are symptomatic, right now they say quarantine 14 days, and then it is required for you to get a test to return to work. So pretty much all I did is I had very mild symptoms. So I stayed home for 14 days and then didn't really necessarily have to take any medication. I mean, I was just monitoring myself for a fever. You know, and they just tell you if you are experiencing a fever, take an NSAID, you know, which could be like ibuprofen, it could be Aleve, pretty much anything over the counter, and then you just go back to work.
How do doctors know who is going to make it and who's not? Like, or is it just, you just don't know?
That's the thing, is you don't know.
You don't know.
All they do right now is they treat the symptoms. For some people, their symptoms are very severe. And that's not always somebody with a pre-existing condition. But that's the thing about it, is that they don't know, which is why you should be very careful, because they don't know. And I really, to be honest, I wish they would stop acting like they do know. That's the part for me that's so frustrating, you know, for the person who's the leader of this country to, I took this drug and you just took an NSAID. You know, you didn't get something that was just so specially made and whatever for you. You just got an NSAID, you know.
So he's not telling the truth about that.
No.
They, which we should expect, because he, no, you know, he 2,000 lives a week, something like that.
No, there's nothing more specialized out there for them to give one person versus the other. That's what they're still trying mm-hmm. to work on. Now, they do have mm-hmm. vaccination trials that are going on, but there's nothing that's been proven to say, well, this is what seems to be whatever effective versus this and versus that. They don't know. And yeah. so that's why
I would say it's a stock ploy. It's a stock
they
ploy.
Don't, to get this well, see, stock you, up. You got to remember that a lot of our politicians, a lot of our Congress people, they lobby with pharmaceutical companies. That's what they do. Mm-hmm. A lot of them have mm-hmm. investments. A lot of them have now bought into like PPE, like how they said Sonny Perdue now owns stock in yeah. PPE. So, you know, a lot of that comes into play, but they really don't know. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that I feel like is not, they're not being honest about it. But see, the thing about it is when you downplay it, that sets the precedent for other people to follow. Yeah, which is exactly. why, in my opinion, it was not handled well. Because if the person at the top is just, oh, you know, it's no big deal, then people are going to not think it's a big deal. You mm-hmm. know, you are the main influencer in our society. So if you don't mm-hmm. think it's X, Y, and Z, or it's not serious, it's not real, then why would the next person who listens to every word that comes out of your mouth thinks it's real?
Right. I got a question then. What would you say to the person that says, well, listen, we don't know. So because we don't know and, you know, we have no idea what's really going on, I'm just going to live my life.
Mm-hmm.
What
I mean,
would you say to that person?
You can live your life, but just be mindful of the other lives around you.
Wow.
You know, so just remember, it's not just your world. There are a lot of us mm-hmm. that live in it with you.
Right.
So that's
a good quote.
Yeah. That's my
listen,
take.
Listen, Jihan, it has been a pleasure to have you on.
Yes, it is definitely. I'm glad to help in any way. Glad to help.
Yeah. So, man, that was Jihan, man. Jihan El Shabazz, Director of Rehabilitation and Occupational Therapy. Man, that was a great dialogue we just had with her. So,
yeah, it was.
So Freddie B, you feel any differently? Like, just, you know, talking to our distinguished guest?
Do I feel any different? I mean, man, selfish, you said, do I feel any differently?
See, still selfish.
No. I mean, no, I think that's something, you know, I mean, like what she said goes, you know, it's big, that's bigger than COVID, obviously, you know. It's not just you in the world. That's bigger than COVID. That's life. At the end of the day, you know, we live in life. Life ain't fair. You know, that's the real. That's just me. I'm the type, I'm just direct and I'm just real. Life ain't fair. Stuff gonna happen. People gonna get beat. People gonna be mad. People gonna be sad. People gonna be lonely. People gonna die. That's the dark side of everything. You know, so it don't matter what you come with or what angle you come with on how to deal with this, it's gonna be a big chunk of America that's gonna get hit, and they're gonna get hit hard, and they're gonna feel lost, and they're gonna feel forgotten. And that just is what it is. And unfortunately, we live in a world where we're trying to placate and we're trying to pacify everybody, but you can't please all the people all the time.
Ms. Monroe, any final thoughts?
Yeah, mine is the exact opposite of Fred.
That's all right. That's fair. Hey, listen, it's your feelings, baby. There's too many feelings. That's why we got them. So,
right, we got too many feelings.
Too many feelings. Go ahead, tell us.
Yeah, I think if we had just shut down earlier on, yeah, it would have hurt some people. But I think that, especially if we had shut down across the nation for at least a solid 6 weeks, and like truly essential, not I need to work at the grocery store, not I need to work at Amazon, truly essential, like, you know, healthcare workers, people that assist them, like, the, you know, the janitors, things like that. If we had truly shut down for 6 weeks straight, yes, some people would have still have gotten hurt, but I think the number would be far less severe. And not only that, now that we've extended it so far, now our numbers are still honestly way too high, and we're going into flu season, because people tend to forget 2017 flu season, we lost 80,000 people just in America. Mm-hmm. And generally every year, I think it's what, 250,000 to 500,000 globally to flu. Like, we honestly don't even take flu seriously enough. And so now you're going to add COVID on top of that, and I think it's just going to make things far worse. So we're going to be feeling the repercussions of us not just truly shutting down early on and kind of nipping this thing in the bud. We're going to be feeling this for years now because we didn't just take that small sacrifice then.
My final thoughts on the whole topic is simply this. You know, I'm going to listen to my advisors, you know, the people who are important to me and I believe in I'm going to take the advice. I'm going to stay my butt in the house as much as I can. So, look, listen, we can go on and on and on about this topic. It seems we have too many feelings about this today.
We damn sure do.
We got too many feelings. 2020 has been crazy with COVID-19. So, if you are out there, send us a message. Our handles are in the description. Let us know
how you feel.
How you feel and how you're doing. How you doing with COVID-19? We love to hear your feedback. This has been yours truly, T Staples, and I've been here with
Miss Monroe
and your boy.
It's your main man, Freddie B. Tell me why you're mad.
He said, tell me why you're mad. But listen, thank y'all for listening to Too Many Feelings. Peace. Mm-hmm.